Anyhow, so I will thank you. I will. This is the second conversation I've had today, which said 20 seconds, and I am horrible about washing my hands, even under optimal conditions. But I will.
Yes.
You hear that, folks? Wash your hands.
Yeah. Okay. Well, what I'm saying is if your habits are that you bring out your phone when you're eating, you know, if you don't wash your phone, you wash your hands, and then you go touch your phone, you've lost the effect of washing your hands. The virus is on your phone. You have to wash your phone when you wash your hand.
So
if you bring your phone while you're eating.
So you need to carry a little handy wipe with you or something.
Now, we'll do it. Just take some soap on the screen. Rub it on the screen with your fingers.
Not just the screen. There's two sides and an edge. So you really have to wash the whole thing, and so
I guess so. I don't know.
So
it's a lot of people are going to be infected by their phones, I think.
You know what we could do as a great service might go viral? If we could do a little video where we show people a tried and true, test this method for washing your phone, something you can carry in your pocket, you know, that you wipe the phone both sides, wash your hands, that's it.
Yeah.
Throw it away. But then, of course, when you walk out of the bathroom, if you're in a public place, you touch the doorknob or the handle and you pull it and it's...
You either use your elbow to... If you have to touch the door, touch it where other people aren't going to touch it.
But if
higher or lower. If there's a handle, just wait a few seconds. Unlock it and wait till somebody opens it for you from the other side.
No, people are not going to do that. The whole thing where you wash your hands and whatever towel or towelette you use is what you
keep. Yeah. Don't throw out the towelette in the bin inside the washroom because you need that to open the door handle and then throw it out in a garbage outside of the washroom. Like you just think about techniques. And the object is you don't want to touch areas that are definitely high traffic. Now, an interesting thing is copper is a metal. The virus gets killed on the surface of copper. It hates copper.
Oh.
Okay. So I've got this copper water bottle and it has copper ions. It's supposed to be a big thing in India. I just picked it up in a store a few months ago. And if we copper plated the push, the elevator buttons, for example, or doorknobs, like just copper plated them, then the transmission would be a lot lower.
That's fascinating. That's fascinating.
Yeah. Yes. So there's some property about copper. You know, it's a very good conductor. There's lots of electrons that move on the surface of copper. And you were saying that the virus is polar, which I was wondering, because then if it's polar and it's affected by electric fields, I could see wearing a mesh instead of the old copper scrubbing things for pots. If you had a fine mesh of copper and you had a 9-volt battery and you put some charge on it, you know, maybe that would completely eliminate any transmission of the virus. Like,
that's interesting.
You know, those masks are, that's 100-year-old or more technology, right? We have images from the 1918 influenza people wearing these, and people say they're not that effective. I mean, I think they're effective if you're infected and you sneeze, it stops spreading to other people. But the reason they're not so effective in the general population walking around with them is because people aren't going to replace them at the proper interval like they do in hospitals. So over time, they can get quite dirty. And then when your hand's adjusting them on your face, you can get your hands coated, right? So there's a lot of thought needs to go into what we really need to do.
And unfortunately, whereas you and I are systems thinkers looking at the bigger picture and associating disparate elements to try to come up with an approach. Most we have cultivated a population in the United States, probably in most of the developed world, which are not the systems thinkers. People are not encouraged to think about problems in that way. We've gone to a reductionist. You study biology. You study chemistry. Yeah. You study physics. Yeah. You study economics.
And there's no connecting of the fields or dots. I mean, one of the concerns in the U.S. that I have is I think the fatality rate is going to be you know, extremely high, than higher than in other countries for a number of reasons. And I haven't seen them touched on. I mean, there's some that are touched on, like if it costs you a couple grand to get a test, you know, you're not going to get a test. So there'll be lots of people untested going to their jobs. And if they don't get relief, they have to go to their jobs, right? If they go from paycheck to paycheck, whether they're sick or not. But also, isn't there something like, no, I don't know if it's 2/3 of the population is obese, right? And they suffer from heart issues and circulatory issues and lung issues even.
Yes.
And they're overweight. They're not that healthy. So the death rate is going to be a lot higher in those populations, I think.
Well, I think the single most critical factor in how high our death rate is going to be is the absolute idiot who's present.
Yeah.
I mentioned this in my last conversation. I'll mention it to you as well.
Yeah.
Through my contact with the intelligence community, I understand, and this is not classified information. I understand that that Trump fired or disassembled the pandemic, the chain of command of the pandemic response team last year, as recently as last year.
Yeah.
Yeah. So this man is like just, he's not just stupid. It's like, it's like he's constantly driving
things worse. Yeah.
It's like backwards, you know,
it's like he's a Manchurian candidate. He's not working for the US. Right.
Well,
and then you get these conspiracy theories. He's weakening the country.
It's worse than that. He's not working for China. He's not working for Russia.
Yeah.
In my opinion, he's working against nature. He's working.
Yeah.
He is so.
Yeah.
So such an evil being that, you know, he chooses to anything that's environmentally positive. He chooses to back out of it. Like, why back out of the Clean Air and Water Act? You know, why back out? Why? And then he'll lie about it. He'll say, oh, we've got the best air and the best water in the, you know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It's just, I mean, it's all super extreme. And, you know,
he is the single most dangerous pathogen on the planet.
Yes.
He's pathogenic to humanity. He's pathogenic to nature.
Yes.
And he's pathogenic to himself. But he doesn't see that. His money is dependent upon nature.
Yeah. No, I know. So let's talk about China a little bit, because China's fascinating in terms of at the peak, you know, when at the peak, the worst day, they were getting 15,000 new cases a day. And now they're down to 15 a week.
I'm holding up my finger because, as I said in my last conversation, and this may get edited in or out. The word I have from a very close friend who was born in China and lives in the United States now is, for instance, any numerical representation China gives out, you can add one or two zeros and probably not be far off from the truth. So when China reports 8,000 deaths, there are mass graves in which a far greater number have died.
So Italy, we're probably getting much better numbers.
Much more accurate. Iran also has mass graves. They're doing mass burials.
Yeah, I mean, the key thing is that you're only doing a sample. Any measurement where you're doing the test, positive, negative, is a sample. Like, it's the people that get sick, they go in, they get tested, right? But the number of people that have the virus, right, is probably at least 10 or 20 or 30 times higher than that number. And they're asymptomatic.
Yeah. Now the third conversation I'm going to have, and I want you to go back to China for a moment but the third conversation I'm going to have is with Peter Wadhams tonight. And he made this point to me in an email, and I said, Peter, we've got to do this in a video. You know, so and then when I said that to him, I emailed you immediately afterwards. I said, Paul, we got to talk.
Yeah.
But the point he was making is that if you have exponential growth at 2%, that's a doubling in 2%.
Yeah.
Two out of 100, that's a doubling in 37 years. If you have 50%, that's a doubling in 2 years.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean,
wait. So if we are told, for every patient who's infected with the coronavirus, they will tend to infect two other people, that's doubling.
Yeah.
Okay. And the time frame is not per annum, per year, as in the former examples I just gave.
Yeah.
But that's every 2 weeks. So you're basically doubling the number of infections every 2 weeks, unless you do a lockdown and figure out how to cleanse all services. And
you mean every 2 days or every 2 weeks?
Well, it's
2 weeks. See, I think anyway, it's a very short period of time. It's not years. I got to say one thing. Okay. We have about 150,000 cases, give or take, now in the world. It took 97 days to get the first 100,000. It's taken 8 days to get the next 50,000.
And that's exponential growth. And that's the point I'm making. I was trying to lay it out mathematically in a way that was conservative. I said 2 weeks because that's the amount of time it takes before you know you've got it. So I'm using that 2 week number.
Yeah. And the other things are, too, is that, you know, it's a chessboard problem. Okay. A guy was challenging a king to a chess game. And if he beat the king, the king said, I'll give you tons of rice or whatever. And the guy said, no, just give me one rice for the first square on the board, two grains of rice for the second square, four for the third square, et cetera. You know, and the king thinks that's not very much, so says yes. And then, of course, the king loses. And, you know, then they start adding it up, and it's like more rice than there exists in the entire world, you know, way, way more. Or the best thing with exponential growth is, let's say you have lily pads on a little pond, and they're doubling every day, okay? Mm-hmm. How much of the pond is, and the pond's completely covered after 30 days, you know, how many days before the pond is half covered?
One day.
And the answer is, the answer is 29 days and the pond's half covered, and then it's doubled, and then you get 100% coverage. So it's just, it blows up completely. And we're seeing countries, you know, we're seeing the increase exponential, which doesn't seem that bad initially, and then blows up. So Italy is a great example. Nine cases, 10 days later, they're under quarantine, the entire country, right? And then, basically, I mean, Spain just happened, Norway just happened, all of these countries that are above the, above this threshold of number of cases are heading there. The whole world will probably be locked down within several weeks, perhaps.
Now, this is obviously a humanitarian tragedy, but since I am a contrarian by nature, ever since I spent a couple of years on Wall Street, where it's known that the herd, the thundering herd, is always going to be wrong at some critical juncture.
Yes.
I mean, okay. Yeah. I'm a contrarian. I try to say it as gently as possible, that this is a blessing in disguise in certain ways.
It's a
wake-up call. It's a wake-up call, just how fragile our economic system is.
Exactly.
And it needs to be replaced. And this offers, people are beginning to say, God, I wish I had some tomatoes growing in my backyard. I wish I had some lettuce. You know, people are beginning to understand the value of independence and security, food security, and how we have a fragile system when we depend upon going to Safeway or some other supermarket.
Yeah, and supply chains and things. I have a question for you with your experience on Wall Street.